Hi again. Welcome to the beautiful world of interpretation. Today we are going to cover the lecture you're having, the reading material, in a way that I can explain some of the things which are unclear. And we are going to go over together and let's see how we are doing together. Professional conference interpretation. Let's remember, what was it again? The conference interpretation profession is a growing industry today. No worries, no wonder. The demand for this career is going up. At the same time, the number of working languages is increasing. So before, maybe it was just, when I was growing up, it was just French, German, English, finished. Nowadays, also with the division of some of the Eastern European countries, and we are having different countries in the world separated, some of the languages are becoming more popular and the business is growing for your good, all that. And yes, many are becoming interested to be in this field because of that too. Together with all these growing figures, there is an urgent call for interpreters to preserve quality and standards in the conference interpreting profession. Like every job, ladies and gentlemen, when the competition grows, you have to be better than them. So that actually is a good thing. That challenge increases the capacity, the professionality, and the accuracy, and basically makes you a better interpreter at the end. Let's look at together the ethics in professional conference interpretation. To maintain and advance the conference interpretation profession's honor and dignity, and to protect and develop the trust of the people who rely on conference interpreters, you must at all times be professional, upright, and a person who knows and practices confidentiality. As a conference interpreter, you must always perform and keep the highest standards of professional ethics. Remember, you are a professional with significant responsibilities to your colleagues, clients, listeners, and speakers, not lesser than a doctor of medicine, not lesser than a lawyer. So everything is depending on your confidentiality, as you can probably guess. You have the entire discretion when to apply the principles to definite situations, and you must rely on your own best decision. Listed below, we're going to go through that now, are several of the most significant professional ethics and their implication that you have to remember. One, as a conference interpreter, to accept more than one project for the same period of time is not a professional move. Moreover, if you try to get out the contract you prior accepted just to give way to a more attractive project. So, for example, ladies and gentlemen, some people, when you feel that, you know, the tap, the faucet is running, as long as it's running, you want to collect water. You know, the more it's dripping and running, you want to collect water. Water is money, you know what I mean. That's not going to be working like that. So, I shouldn't catch this word. I shouldn't forget that. No, that too. Don't be greedy. Be selective. Because you cannot focus on two or three different and such responsible jobs in the same time. Impossibly. You will probably miss certain things, and at the end, instead of earning $50 from here, $50 from here, maybe you will get it once, but the quality of your job will probably be reduced, and next time you will wait a long time for the next $50. So please consider that. Okay, number two, avoid doing work that might bring shame on your profession. Again, self-ethics. When you go to bed in the nighttime, you should be able to put your beautiful head and smart head to the pillow with really a good conscience. And don't sell your own ethics for a couple of dollars. I'm sure that you're not going to do it, but our task is to remind you of. Our task is here even to talk to the little, sometimes little devil in your brain. Because smart people have a bit of a devilish thinking too, which is very good for your job if you use it in a positive way, for sure. But sometimes we have our weaknesses. We all have our weaknesses. That's why when we talk about the ethics, we feel actually the, let's say, responsibility to remind you of certain little things. I'm 100% sure you will be not having any misstep in there. And you should not recognize any project or circumstance that's outside your profession decorum. So you might not know, maybe until you get the right information about the job, how much difficulties it can put you in. And that's why, we'll cover that again, that's why we say before getting the job, inquire a lot of information as you can, as much as you can, so that you exactly know what are you getting into. Number three, do not take advantage on the classified information you may obtain in the course of the session. Anything that is confidential is exclusively for the project use only and absolutely not for your personal gain. So as long as you have the mask and the task of an interpreter, you deal with the secret material or not so open to public material, but the moment you take your coat or mask as an interpreter off, it's done. It's gone. It's none of your business, basically. Four, once you agree to a project, it's your ethical responsibility to give your best and work with all due professionalism and to a high professional standard. Be accountable enough to comprehensively get ready. Five, the client or the speaker you are interpreting is dependent on you. So you are responsible to faithfully, precisely, and wholly relay the speaker's message, no matter what the point of view or stand of the speaker is. Do not break the client's trust. It is your moral obligation to do your job with all truthfulness. That's why, ladies and gentlemen, we always say, get informed about what you're dealing with. Because if it is, again, like in the second point, if it's a shameful thing that you feel bad about afterwards, don't get the job. But once when you considered all the information, went through and did all the preparation, then please trust your client so that he can trust you or she can trust you. Then it's kind of a trust relation between you and your client. Keep it until you finish your job. That's what's basically mean here. Six, to make certain the interpretation's utmost quality, do your best to secure reasonable working conditions all the time. This will serve as your responsibility to your contemporaries by a stronger reason if you're acting as consultant, interpreter, or team leader. What does that mean in more simple English? So working conditions, that actually covers everything from the temperature, light, and you know, setting, where you're sitting and how you're dealing with people, with your voice, all the equipment, and everything is involved. Seven, you do not work alone in a conference interpreting, obviously. You'll be dealing with a team. So, always be loyal and supportive to them. Yes, you have to get along with them all the time as a team member and a good citizen. Be a team player. Think of like a soccer player. You know, sometimes you want to kill your friend, you're angry or something, but you wouldn't reflect that on the match. Yeah, otherwise the good viewers or the fans will be very angry at you. So be professional, leave your personal conflicts and tensions outside. I don't think that you're going to have it easily though. So, eight, you know your expertise, qualifications, and limitations. Do not accept, therefore, any projects which are beyond your knowledge and capability. If you think the task being assigned to you is too technical, that need to have enough experience and more preparation time to be an effective interpreter, you can always say no to that assignment. That probably is better than a later embarrassment or feeling unready and maybe unqualified or, you know, it's an embarrassing situation. You wouldn't want to do that. And because I think after every interpretation, you must have that feeling to say, that was a good job, Leila, to yourself, so that your client feels the same thing. So it's your conscious, your heart and your brain should be working together. Your values, we talked about. So that's why pay very much attention to your own capacities. For example, so I am working for this beautiful university with a heart. But now, if my bosses or my partners ask me to, because I'm a good lecturer, let's say, would you please give some chemistry lessons, Leila? It doesn't matter. We're going to prepare you the curriculum and you're just going to read because you're nice, you're reading like you're talking. No. Because I don't know the matter, subject matter. Chemistry, oh my God, that was my worst subject in high school. I wouldn't do that. My best money in the world. So please have that consciousness. Okay, let's look at here. 9. And you must observe the law of confidentiality at all times. Any information brought up to during the sessions is not to be disclosed to the public. That's obviously. Always consider the privacy of all persons you are going to deal with, not only your client. We are talking about a team here. You have the responsibility as that team. Remember that you are bound by the strictest secrecy as a professional interpreter, you and all the team members. Okay, so now we have the health and stress matters. What's going on in here? Are we in a medicine thing? No. But every job has its risks and health challenges. Let's look. Conference interpretation is, in fact, a demanding profession. Are you ready to engulf the high stress nature of your job? Really? Have you ever thought about that? How stressful it can be? If you're following our modules, lectures, lecture by lecture, module by module, you actually must have already realized what are you going into. But let's remember again. You can do it by simply considering your health condition and taking care of yourself. Live a healthy and active lifestyle. Ladies and gentlemen, you might be a drinker, you might be a smoker, social drinker we're talking about here. You might be eating too little or too much. And then you might think, doesn't matter, it's my mouth and my brain which will be doing that work. No. Your body and your soul. Your body and your mind is actually one. You need both. Don't forget that. First, start with the basics. You just have to eat right, unfortunately, we have to say that. Exercise regularly. Sorry, big belly interpreters like myself. See, if I decide to interpret, I have to get rid of a lot of my weight, probably. And have at least 6 to 8 hours sleep and practice stress management methods. Yeah, when I was interpreting, I was slimmer, by the way. You can do some meditations at home, or you can enroll to yoga classes. We are not joking, honestly. You have to have that balance, that like an actor, exactly the same, because you are going to jump into somebody else's role, like an actor, because you are going to be his voice. You should be able to keep your neutrality, confidentiality, professionality. You don't imagine, you cannot imagine how much it costs your health and your brain. So you have to be fit like an Olympic athlete. Second, consider the tools of your job. Yes, your hearing and your voice need your special attention. It is advisable for you to have a baseline audiometric test. If you're just starting, this is the best time for you to have this checkup. In the occasion of accidental hearing injury, this will help you to have confirmation of work-related injury. And last, practice good time management. It will surely help you stay away from stress. That's easier said than done, I know, but you can do your best. Or you, at least you cannot ask for stress. You can kind of slalom if something occurs during the time, especially when you're preparing for a conference interpretation. If your wife or your children are making problems, or your husband, say, excuse me, guys, I have to focus, leave me alone. Okay, you can be a better time manager now. Find time to do all these for your own good. Now you can understand what kind of a discipline this whole thing requires. Good health and stress-free lifestyle matter in your work. Actually, you know what? In all kinds of works. But here again, since you're actually having more responsibility on your shoulders, even more than a translator who is having the luxury of being alone with the paper, with the material, maybe at home smoking, or maybe not sleeping, maybe sleeping, then he can do the time management a little bit, or accept the deadline or the due date accordingly, thinking of his or her lifestyle, who's maybe not the healthiest one. Maybe, I'm saying. But with interpretation, it's almost impossible, because you are there. With your flesh and blood, you are there. So you have to take care of yourself very well. Okay, it was mentioned about you how you can avoid stress and how to stay healthy at all times. Nevertheless, you also have to know what stressors to watch out for. Speakers reading from texts, fast speakers, lack of background material, difficult accents, booth discomfort, lack of preparation time, undisciplined speakers, and your family who probably turned you crazy one day before, all that matters. Learn how to deal with them. You may apply it through improved communication with clients and speakers, but you can do more, and you have to do more for the betterment of your team. For instance, in preparation for the session, you have to ensure all documents, manuscripts to be read out, are made available to your team in advance, that you have enough time to get ready, and that the pace of reading of such texts is controlled. This is significant for you and your colleagues to raise understanding of and respect for your working environment, to keep away from stress. Written preparation, even if it's a talking job here, written preparation, knowing what to do, sharing that information with your team is here very necessary. Keep improving, says our next title. Let's see why, how, where. Every person has to keep on learning on whatever profession he may in. But as a conference interpreter, you must commit yourself to permanent learning. Don't worry, you're not alone. As a teacher, you should do that too. So I am also keeping a kind of pace and track with everything I'm dealing with. That's actually for everybody, even a doctor. You, if you're a doctor, even if you're a famous professor, very prominent, you have to follow all the articles, even on your, maybe on your branch, on your subject, maybe in other subjects. You have to be aware. You have to be keeping up with the time, because we are in an information age, as you know. You know it better than I do. You are more like an IT generation than I have been. So please keep up with the newest. Okay, you also have to put into account what is constant in the world, change, that is. The something which is never changing is the change itself. For you to keep up with the demands of your profession, you need to develop together with the constant changes in language, media, technology, and the like. Be updated all the time to cope up with the developments in your profession. Yeah, well, specifically I mentioned the medical field, also law for sure, but medical field. When you just even watch a little bit of a medical channel, Discovery Channel or whatever, documentary, or look at some of the articles, you'll see that even every single day people are discovering something new. And we always say language. Language is like a living organism. It's living and breathing. It's changing. It's developing. It's accepting many vocabulary, many terms, not only from subject to subject, also from generation to generation. So it basically grows in two directions, like two-dimensional, three-dimensional almost. Like generations are creating new languages and new sectors are creating new languages. So you have to be able to keep up with all that. Okay, so There are so many things to develop on your knowledge and skills. One is your language expertise. Maybe you're proficient in 3 or 5 or more languages. You have to improve them all through the media and the internet. Language is changing continuously, and usage differs in various places as time passes by. Keep updated of cultural, linguistic, and social improvement in all of your languages, and particularly those spoken outside your residence country. It's easier for your residence country. If you are a Korean and you live in Seoul, say, you might definitely get involved easily with what's happening in Jeju Island. Or when you are Turkish and you live in Istanbul, if somebody has created a slang in the Black Sea area, you are more connected because you live in this country. But what happens if you're a Filipino sitting in Philippines and you're in big and very good command of English, but how do you know the Eastern Canadians, Maritimes, for example, or Florida has suddenly come up with a term? So you see how internationally you have to be thinking. Okay, study the use of words and expressions in different nations and carefully listen to how language is used by native speakers. A good thing when you actually follow some of the series, but pay attention and figure out which language they are using. Is more Texas? If it's English, for example. Is it more Texas? Is it South American? Is it North American? So, you know, it differs. Or is it British? Or is it New Zealander? So it differs from region to region, even English. So is every single language. Over time, your listeners will notice how quickly and smoothly your tongue adjusts from one language into another and another. Just keep on practicing. Invest on reference books and technical dictionaries. These are tools of your job that you should always make available for future need. You may solicit advice from your more experienced contemporaries and let others borrow your reference books if needed. You can also take some notes. There are lots of gadgets nowadays. You can actually use your smartphones or your tablets or whatever and keep everything in your folders and files. When you see something, save it. When you see something, save it. Then analyze them. Then maybe create your own aid book one day like that. And there are now many dictionaries to choose from. That's true too. Prefer those with definitions, diagrams, and explanations. Thesaurus, same meaning, synonyms, very important. You do not just buy books, but you have to open and read them up. I love that. That's so true. Because we feel so good when we actually own some books. But when it comes to reading, we are sometimes lazy. So when you bought them, please read them. Okay. Study the theories about the subjects concerned in the session and learn about controversies, development, and thoughts, which are essential in the field. Discover more about economics, law, and technology. You might say, wait a minute, I am only dealing with a little bit of politics in some meetings like G20 or whatever, and I'm going to be a conference interpreter, like maybe for some international political meetings. What am I going to do with law? This is not a technology meeting, it's not NASA. No. Even in politics today, especially in politics or social meetings, all these subjects might be coming up, so be informed. You also have to research deeper into the diverse specialized subjects that you interpret. Try to assess your own presentation. With the permission of the organizer or during public meetings, you may record your interpretation job. Be aware. Then listen to your own voice and do your criticisms afterwards. If you're not happy about what you have heard, pay attention to the details that you need to improve. Can I share something with you? A secret? My bosses are not listening now. When I'm having these lectures all the time, my boss is sending me a sample, kind of edited sample, so that I know myself by heart for 30 years being in front of behind camera. No, I have to know how I'm actually working for this job in front of the camera. Am I talking too fast? Am I talking too, you know, maybe too unclear or whatever, too much? Are my hands and gestures and everything are sometimes too much? Believe me, I am criticizing myself looking at the samples of this job. So it's always good to watch yourself, listen to yourself. Yes? Deal with your weak spots thoroughly, it says here. If you have a linguistic problem, make an effort to spend more time in a country of that language. If you cannot go there, you can watch more YouTube, much more movies or political discussions and news, even anything about this country. You can also enroll to language enhancement courses, for sure, if you can do it in your location. On the other hand, make a constant effort to fill in your knowledge of your weak areas if you're having difficulty in content. If you notice you have speech problems and mannerisms, try to attend speech classes if you cannot deal with them by yourself alone. Yes, you are going to be a public speaker. Poor delivery, an unpleasant voice, can really affect your job. Can you imagine now somebody is talking here in a beautiful language and says something in, say, Arabic, and says, رئيس الولاية المتحدة الأمريكية, and then you say, the American president of, oh yeah, you know, this beautiful Misri Arabic suddenly, you know, got into your voice like that. That's terrible. I wouldn't want to listen to that. So maybe you're not aware. Maybe you have some problem like that. Get aware of it and fix it. Everybody can fix it. Okay, so that's normal. Actually, you can learn from them. Carefully listen to them while at work and find out how they deal with particular difficulties. A professional voice coach, I told you, can help improve your voice and delivery. This is another personal investment for your own improvement. Voice and delivery are essential to you as an interpreter. Anyway, your colleague can help you also. Your seniors, you know, the people who have been more or longer in this job. You can request him to listen to you during a session and to comment on both content and delivery afterwards. You can be of aid too. If someone asks you to do the same, remember to be constructive in your observations. So actually even observing can even help you. You can actually, by correcting people, you can also correct yourself sometimes. It's always good to have the interaction with your colleagues. Aim to acquire new learning every conference. Wow. When you encounter difficult texts which are not confidential, keep them after a session. Then go over them when you get home, evaluate the difficulties and discover good solutions. You can always improve your work performance in so many ways. Just make it a habit and do it with discipline. Now, before the conference, inquiries, options, and firm offers. Every time you have a possible project, there are three things that may be proposed to you: an inquiry, an option, or a firm offer. But you have to make sure the availability of your schedule before accepting any assignments, which falls under an inquiry. We talked about the ethic part, but here now it's the mechanic part, the practical part of saying yes or no to a job. This is an introduction stage of contact, that basically a request for information about your possible availability. Either the recruiter or the interpreter has no obligations to assume yet on this stage. The second one mentioned is an option. Now, what's that? Here, you'll be presented an offer for work that is subject for your affirmation. As soon as you acknowledge an option, there are three possible situations. First is when the assignment is established, obviously. The recruiter shall advise you right away to engage your services for the particular dates under the arranged terms. Next is when the assignment is canceled. Here, the recruiter shall inform you at once and release you from the option. Sure, you have to make sure all these things, if you are on your own, you have to have a policy, like a cancellation policy, like a notice policy. Imagine you got a job, you've been called for tomorrow at 4 o'clock here and there, and suddenly they cancel it the same day. Shall they? Or shall they make you know, like have a notice 24 hours beforehand? So these things you should be exactly in know of about yourself in your job policy, work policy. Last is when the option is either confirmed or cancelled. When this happens, you can entertain a firm offer for a new conflicting project. But before you accept a firm offer, you have to contact first the holder of the option and give them the right of first refusal. The option holder will be obliged to either confirm the option or release you at this point. Remember that you are giving a recruiter a right of first refusal for the concerned dates in accepting an option. Do not confuse yourself. So you have to be very planned. There is no joking about this. Because conference, ladies and gentlemen, is not like you are helping a friend to talk with a doctor or something. This is different. This is a big thing. It's a big organization. So that should be really also organized as a in a big matter. The third one is a firm offer. This builds a binding commitment between the interpreter and the recruiter when accepted. This offer can be completed and acknowledged in writing, orally, and by means of advanced communication technology like email. When you accept the firm offer, written contract signing follows. This formal written agreement shall state each party's rights and responsibilities, settled arrangements, and working situations. Now, the right questions to ask. Be sure to inquire all the relevant information we were talking about to the recruiter before you say yes to any project. This practice will help you stay away from any unpleasant surprises. You remember the ethical thing? Or many more? Check the list of questions below that you may ask the recruiter. Let's look at them now to make sure that we can easily and in good conscience say yes or no to a job. Then there were also questions you have to ask yourself for sure, like we were talking about. Am I good enough for this job? But this is here. You're certain? You know your job? It's okay. The topic, the matter, the subject, everything is close to you. But first, what is the nature of the meeting and subject matter? Two, when is the schedule and where is it going to be held? Three, how long will the conference last? Four, how are the technical conditions of booths, equipment, etc.? Five, what are the language regime and the languages will I work from or into? Six, when will the documents and text be available? Remember, you have to look at them and share with your team beforehand. Seven, who are going to be my team members, booth mates, and team leader? Eight, is the interpretation will be recorded and or broadcasted? Nine, what is the mode of interpreting to be used? Is it simultaneous only or consecutive or whispering? One of them, or maybe all of them altogether. It depends. How about the social functions I'll be recovered? Like, are there any dinners, field trips, etc. that I need to shoulder? Financially too. How much is the professional fee? How about the travel expenses, accommodation, and DSA? When is confirmation expected in the case of an option? May I know the terms of payment? So, before you actually talk to your own brain, after having these answers and imagine, everything speaks for your favor and you're definitely about to take and accept the option, still ask your self-consciousness and good conscience both. Am I good for this job? Now it's your turn to ask yourself. How to handle conflicting offers and availability management? Yeah, so money is sweet. So you don't want to say no if a job has all these requirements you actually can fulfill and there is nothing which can bother you ethically, but you have a time management problem and suddenly nothing comes, you know, Murphy. And then suddenly four things come together. Okay, conflicts are common in any profession and institution. In conference interpretation, there are circumstances when various projects overlap from one another. In this case, you should know how to handle these conflicts in a professional and ethical way. This is a vital practice in your career as a conference interpreter. First step. When you start the discussion of your possible project with a recruiter, you have to make it clear what will be presented before you. Double check if it's an option or a firm offer. Update your planner. Clearly mark the status of each meeting on your engagement calendar. You have to note what stage of the process your possible project has arrived at. And confirm responsibilities per stage in the process that you and the client have correspondingly assumed. Second step. Be smart with all your transactions. Protect yourself by signing a written contract after acknowledging a firm offer. Note then that the contract should include an explicit cancellation clause stipulating your professional fees should your project is cancelled or shortened. That's what I'm saying. You are at risk with no such written agreement. They cancel, you prepared, and you got nothing. Without it, it is possible for you not to get paid if your assignment is cancelled, so watch out for recruiters who present you a firm offer but decline to back it up with a written contract including a cancellation policy. It is chiefly essential to ensure that you sign such an agreement before you turn down other work for the same time. Can you imagine? You're dealing with it and there's another job, so when I say yes to that, you're going to definitely lose the other one, but before you say yes to that, you should make sure that you're covered. You say yes to that, you say no to that, and the one you said yes is canceled without you being covered. Now you lost both. Not going to happen. Third step, be professional in dealing with all your assignments. It is unethical to get out of any project for the reason that something better has been offered to you. Do you understand that? It's like marriage almost. You fell in love with a woman or with a guy, you marry, and then suddenly you see one, a beautiful one. What are you going to do? Divorce and marry that one? No. You should be really, it's like a joke, but you should be really as ethical as in human relationships here with your job. Okay, so, and it's equally unethical to ask another interpreter in your replacement just for no important reasons. Remember, that is a personal commitment every time you accept any project. Wow. Well, interpreter must be really very, very honest, solid people. In the event that you have valid and serious reasons to ask for a replacement after accepting a contract, you have to look first for a colleague who is available on the agreed dates. Now, she or he is going to ask the same questions to accept this job. Then ask your recruiter if your chosen colleague is suitable as your substitute. Be conscious, though, that if you request to be replaced, your reliability reputation might be affected. So it's very important who you are actually recommending. Should be as correct and solid as you are. Otherwise, stay away. They find another one themselves. Recruiters and working conditions. Each recruiter has diverse level of conference interpreting awareness. Each has his own idea about how conference interpreting works and what are the necessary working conditions to make high quality interpretation possible. You may work with a recruiter who is from an intergovernmental organization. You may receive a work offer from a consultant interpreter, an intermediary, or a direct client. Your work offer may be from direct clients like government agencies, law firms, non-government organizations, NGOs, and private companies. Another offer may come from intermediaries such as translation companies or other coordinators. Some of them may not be acquainted with the proficient requirements and working conditions in professional conference interpreting. Others may or may not have experience working with professional conference interpreters' teams. They may not also be familiar that diplomatic supervision is required. The team leader is the best person to handle this kind of client orientation. So there must be somebody in the team who make them aware of these all inquiries. Working conditions should be up to minimum professional standards so that you as an interpreter can offer a professional standard of interpretation. It's truly frustrating for a good interpreter if insufficient working conditions like bad sound, can you imagine? Non-provision of text, poor visibility are the only hindrances for him to give quality interpretation. That's going to be a really very, very pity, you know. You prepared fantastically, you know your matter, everything is fine, but the micro doesn't function. That's really something to be, oh my God, shooting ahead. Yes, this first pillar of high standard professional conference interpreting is to guarantee professional working conditions. As a professional interpreter, remember to be responsible enough to know professional requirements and necessary working conditions, and to make sure that they are properly observed by whoever gives you the work offer. Keep in mind as well that is your right to turn down the project if you come across some recruiters who refuse to provide appropriate working conditions. That working conditions issue, ladies and gentlemen, is important. So you might be having that all in your policy, in your contract. Because if one of them are missing, your job is going to be affected. Then you're going to stand there as a bad interpreter or not a professional one. So you definitely must have the right to say no if the actually promised condition have been not provided to you. Written contract. Always sign a written contract. This is for you to guarantee good working conditions and to keep you away from unpleasant surprises. The written agreement that you need to sign shall clearly state all the terms and conditions of service. Define and assure professional working conditions. There you go. And include a cancellation clause. If your client presents you with a different contract form, it may not specify the necessary working conditions that will guarantee a high-class interpretation. In this case, you may add all the clauses that you think your contract should include. If your recruiter declines to sign a written contract that promises appropriate working conditions, you should rather cancel the project. This is going to be very cheap money and will harm you, your reputation, and your quality as an interpreter. You may want to directly sign your contract with a conference organizer if an intermediary gives you an offer to work. To prevent any confusion, at least ensure that the conference organizer knows your identity, remuneration, and working conditions. A number of intermediaries actually have been known to hire diverse teams of hopeful amateurs and professionals. If the team members are individually recruited, it is good to know who your teammates will be. Series of intermediaries between you and the actual conference organizer cannot make communication any easier. In fact, it can cause problems in terms of working conditions and documents access. So beware. So basically, ladies and gentlemen, as a closing words, first of all, you have to be able to put your, after you're saying yes to a project, you have to be able to put your head in a good conscience to your pillow so that you don't hate yourself to have said yes to that job. So make sure that from the content, nothing is going to bother you. And also, this is the ethical. Let's make a summary. The second one is you should be aware of the subject matter. You should be actually, your capacity should be allowing you to deal with that matter. And thirdly, you get informed properly. And we gave you examples about the job offer and option and everything. So measure these steps properly. And whoever offers you the job, make sure that you're being covered with a written contract, which includes all your conditions, your environment, dates, cancellation policy, remuneration, and the methods of payment, and all that. Whoever gives you the job, make sure that they are aware of your conditions, working conditions, contract conditions, equipment quality, team. Get to know your team, get to know your subject, get to know who you're dealing with, and let them know what your conditions should be. Then it's guaranteed a success. And we're going to talk about how to prepare in a later one. Don't go anywhere. We'll be with you right now.